And let's have a quick reminder about what Bagram represents.
Many of the ex-Guantanamo detainees who arrived in Cuba via Afghanistan say that the torture and abuse they experienced during their detention was far worse in Bagram than anywhere else. Now, while many are mounting legal challenges and battles for compensation and justice, they fear vital evidence may disappear at the top-secret Bagram detention facility if it is demolished. News of the Pentagon's demolition plans were discovered in a low-key legal application submitted on December 30th to the District Court of Columbia by the Justice Department, which intends to transfer prisoners from Bagram to a newly built facility in nearby Parwan. Lawyers say the plan to demolish Bagram amounts to destroying evidence in the cases of detainees who say they were tortured there. The cages, cells and dungeons in Bagram should be preserved as evidence and treated like crime scenes. The Department of Defense argues that reconstruction at Bagram is necessary, given the administration's plans to supplement existing military forces in Afghanistan with an additional 30,000 troops. While officials have also stated that video and photographic records of the Bagram facility will be created in recognition of its historical significance, it remains unclear whether these records will be made public or even accessible to lawyers defending detainees previously held at Bagram.
Moazzam, you were a guest at Bagram, for want of a better description. Is it essential that they preserve it as it stands now?
It's a crime scene, it's a murder scene, and there are more than one murder that took place, and it's been accepted by the United States administration that two homicides, and they called it homicide, took place at that place. And there have been no full investigations, and I mean ones that have gone into to all of the cases that took place there, not just the murder of the taxi driver that's featured in Taxi to the Dark Side, but also some of the other cases that happened that are still, in my mind, unclear. The family members of those people who were killed have still not had the details explained to them as to how their loved ones were murdered. And also, people were tortured there. Ibn al-Sheikh al-Libi was first brought to Bagram, and then he was sent to different parts of the world and tortured into giving a confession. I myself heard the sounds of a woman screaming that I've told you many times about in Bagram, that I was led to believe was my wife being tortured next door. There are many things that took place in that place that have yet to be completely documented and collated and given as a full factual file to let people know that this is what took place in this place that you're now wanting to demolish, so that, you know, the deeds are all done.
Andy, do you think the British government would be relieved if Bagram was demolished? Is there anything there that would alarm?
Well, I suppose it's part of the same thing, really, as to what their role was partial. So, you know, so it's partly a crime scene for them. But I mean, I think the really big issue is with the Americans, and you know, and I do think it would be symbolically useful for them to remove the physical evidence.
I think it's immaterial from a legal point of view. I don't think it makes any difference in terms of it being...
It might be me thinking that more in terms of, you know, that erasing the existence of a place
as far as the legal case
removes its memory.
If the investigations aren't over and you physically need to look at, here are the cells, you just saw one of the what they call the airlock or the sally port, that's physically where Dilawar, the taxi driver, was held up with his hands tied above his head and where he was beaten physically and then dragged off. That's a scene of the crime. If they destroy that before the investigation's taken place, then it is material. You know,
well, certainly, as we know of two homicides, but, you know, I mean, from your stories and mainly from stories of British guys who are held in Bagram, it seems to me that there were at least five murders in Bagram. Now, you know, those other ones have never been investigated,
exactly,
as you say.
Exactly.
Was British intelligence there when you were taken to Bagram?
Part of our claim, myself, Binyam, and the others, all of us who were held in Bagram, the British intelligence agents came there several times. And I remember telling the agents, myself, the individuals, that, you know, do you know what's happened in this place? Do you know what I've witnessed in this place? What are you going to do about it?
And how did they respond to you?
This is not our call. This is all we can do is simply talk to the Americans.
Which is what comes back to what I was saying, is I think Britain is not necessarily, or was not necessarily, and probably still isn't, in a strong enough position. Britain gains more from the relationship from the United States than it pays back in. Britain would be worse off without that relationship.
Surely what you understand is that British citizens, and I don't say just one me individual, yeah. There were many others, yeah. Is that there is an onus, there's a duty to act upon the interests of and the protection of British citizens, and that's the
absolutely
supposed to be their job.
But they also have to balance that with losing access to material that safeguards many other British subjects. And I'm not saying by any means that you can make that sort of calculus in institution, but it's certainly a very difficult call for a government to make.
I mean, I don't know,
and that's probably the British government is.
I don't know if there's any documents floating around from these individuals saying that what I've witnessed here was terrible. We've got to do something about that. If there is, then I'd say fair enough. You know, that then at least they did that. But there's nothing
no
to suggest
that.
Have
no documents surfaced yet?
We've seen.
What about the police investigation, Andy? Where is that going? And
I've heard nothing about it recently. I mean, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if you know, it dawdles and you know, we're still wondering some time from now what happened to that one exactly, because it sounds good, doesn't it?
The only other thing that happened, again, as I said, is that I believe in the case of Shakir Armour, also there's been an investigation ordered, which is, again, now it's the second time in the history of Britain that the intelligence services are being investigated by the police. So there should be alarm bells about this. Because
yeah, there should.
There should be some serious alarm bells about this. It's never happened before.
But, you know, I do think that an even more severe issue is when there's evidence of British involvement. So, I mean, you know, there's British meddling in the cases of everybody who ended up in Guantanamo. But the cases of Bishar Awar and Jamil Al-Banna, who were kidnapped in the Gambia because of a tip-off from the British to the Americans, well, this isn't right, is it? And when we're looking at the stories of the British people picked up in Pakistan, where they're claiming that very reasonably, I think, that they were tortured by the Pakistanis
while they were
being questioned on behalf of the British.
Let's get the public view on this. We sent our very own Miss Moneypenny, Curtie Kerai, to the headquarters of Britain's secret intelligence services to ask some very probing questions to passing members of the public about the activity of Britain's spies and torture. Here is her report.
I'm here today in central London, and behind me is the MI6 building where secret decisions have been taken for torture. I want to find out what the Londoners think about this. Do you think the intelligence service are out of the government's control?
I don't think they're out of the government's control, but they may not be showing all the information they have.
No, I think in countries like the UK and USA, I think everything is under control, the way it should be. I don't know much about the intelligence service, but I think that's the right way as well, because these are things that need to be carried out away from the public eye sometimes. It's the dangerous stuff, it's the most important stuff, and I agree with the way it is.
Do you think the British Prime Minister knew about the detainees who would be tortured?
Again, I don't think he would know directly.
I would have imagined that he didn't know that they were being tortured, perhaps. I think that's probably something that someone at another level takes on at their own accord, you know, it's their decision.
Do you think torture techniques like waterboarding are legitimate in the war of terror?
I don't think any kind of torture is legitimate, but if you have to use it, sometimes you have to use it, but I don't think it's okay.
In a war on terror, there are no boundaries, so, you know, people, like, children are being killed at the same time, like, so I don't see why there should be any boundaries on the other side as well.
I think it's well documented that torture doesn't work, whatever form it is.
Well, you've heard the public opinion, but is it just the case that the British intelligence service are getting far big for their boots? I'm Curtie Kerai, signing off for The Agenda.